Welcome back to Switch to Linux. So I said I was going to get into some more practical Linux things, and so today I wanted to take a little breather out from some of the heavy Linux topics I've been doing. I covered the article from Ars Technica yesterday on Linux Mint, controversies around the Wayland. Of course, we had a couple videos there about Ubuntu and Unity 8, and there's some controversy there, and which is neat. You know, there's just as many thumbs up on that video as there are thumbs down at this video at that point in time, and that's okay. You know, I'm interested in a discussion about this stuff. I want to get some practicality, but I love philosophy as well. And so here we're going to get into a little bit more of that. So what we're going to talk about is how you can basically replace something like you might have an Apple TV or a Roku or something like that. Now, there are certainly the way some of our applications in our modern day work, some of those might be a better way to go. However, if you happen to have a collection of movies in a digital format or music in a digital format, or you have various places around your house where you want to be able to access your music or your movies or things like that, what we're going to do today is we're going to look at that type of functionality. So we are going to be using a system called OpenElec, which is what you can install on any x86 type system. And you can also do the similar thing on a Raspberry Pi with Open Source Media Center. So we're going to have a look at OpenElec today, and I'll probably come back and do one on how to install something on a Raspberry Pi later, just because in case you are unaware of how to do that, it is a little bit different of a process. So to start, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to talk about this computer here, which is a repurposed PC. So I bought this computer back when I was a college professor. I go in to teach, first week of class, computer I had, I think it was a Sony Vaio at the time, just totally crashed out. I'm like, ugh. But hey, I'm a professor now, so I had a little extra cash. I went out to the local, I think I bought it at the local Staples store. I bought this computer, and it was a floor model. I always buy floor models and open box type stuff. This is back when they knew how to make computers, I'll tell you what. Here's your physical toggle switch for your Wi-Fi. You have a VGA port and an HDMI port. Beat that, MacBook Pro. There's three USB ports over here. I'm going to guess that these are all USB 2s. I'm not sure 3 technology was out. We also have a LAN port as availability. In fact, this port here is a little bit different of USB. I think these can also take, there's another type of port that this can take, and I can't remember what it is. We do still have the PCI slots, so it is the era where PCI slot cards were pretty much on the way out, but not entirely gone, and so it still has them. We also have a disk reader here. And I have no idea what this port is right here. If somebody can tell me what this thing is. Can I get that focused? I have no clue. It says 1394, I think. On the other side of the computer, we have our power adapter. We have two more USB ports. One of them, I keep this chip plugged in right here. I'll talk about that chip in a little bit. We have an integrated CD-ROM here. We have two separate headphone jacks, and we have a microphone inline. Don't forget, we have an IR port on the front. This is back when they knew how to make computers. Now, this would be quite a bit different than the computer I'm using here, or I think my other little mini computer's in the other room, so I won't grab that. But there's a couple different types of laptops out there, and I don't like the fact that we're starting to lose some of that genre. This laptop would have been considered a class of laptop that were called desktop replacements. So this guy here is a good several pounds, I mean at least 10 or so pounds. But the idea behind these is that these had enough power in them to replace, a full desktop computer. I mean, slightly less powerful, but they had enough beefiness that they could do that. So this one here, I totally forget the what all of the system specs are. But on the front of it, up here, we actually have our media controls over here as kind of like touchy bar thing, guys. We can access the media player, like a movie player here. There's a stop, a play, skip forward, skip next, volume up, volume down, volume mute. There's an eject button for your disc, some indicator lights, and actually an original old fingerprint scanner. So this computer is just like a total beast. I bought this guy with Windows Vista on it. And it was actually a very good computer because this computer does have quite a bit of RAM in it. It was running, the processor in here does run 32 or 64 bit. And because of that, we were actually, you know, I was actually able to install this operating system because I really wanted to run off 64 architecture. But understand, processors at that time, usually they were capable of 64, but still the 32-bit operating systems were more common. So this had Windows Vista 32-bit operating system installed, although, like I said, they could have done a 64. The other cool thing about this computer is there's actually space inside this. If I open this up, there is space in here for two internal hard drives. And that is like, this is a beastly computer. I will tell you what, this thing rocks. So I didn't have need for an extra Vista computer laying around. And I had fun plans of utilizing the IR port here. I'll talk about that a little bit later here. But what we're going to do is first we're going to walk through a little bit about the software, and then we're going to boot this guy up and I'll show you how to use some of that. So with that being said, here is the OpenElec website. This is at openelec.tv. So OpenElec is a lightweight distro that runs and boots directly into the Kodi Media Center. So I actually installed, if I can find it, and there we go. So what I did is I took out the original hard drive, which was at that time, I don't know how big this guy was. Probably, 250 gigabyte hard drive. So this did originally have a 250 gigabyte hard drive, and I replaced that hard drive with SanDisk SSD, which is 120 gigabyte. So not a huge fan of running SSDs on everything because of the limited life, although I think the limited life still is good enough. But I used the SanDisk SSD, 120 gigabyte, which is the smallest. I'd really like to be able to find these smaller sizes so I can do some more Linux testing directly on drives. However, that being said, I took out the original hard drive, and that's actually still running Vista. If I want to restore this whole computer back to factory with the original Vista operating system, I just pop that drive right in and go. But I took that out, replaced that with the SSD, and then I installed the OpenElec system. So OpenElec here, as you can see, it is a movie organizer and player. It has a picture browser. TV and personal video recorder, I've never used that function. TV show management, this here is either lacking or it can't understand how I organize my TV shows. I'm not sure which. And this is an area that I'm working on. Understand that my work with OpenElec, although I use it and it is highly functional, and this is what I use to watch movies, this is what I use to listen to music anymore, it still is a little bit of a work in progress, mostly because I'm really too busy to sit down and do a whole lot of work with movies and with music. I play stuff as I'm in the office here, but I don't really tinker with the systems nearly as much. There is music and audiobook player, and it is extendable with add-ons. One of the coolest thing that I love about this system is there is a very, very good TED Talk add-on, and I love watching TED Talks. And it just, new talks, I can pop this guy open every week, and there's all the talks that have been added to the TED Talk archive for the last week are right on here, and they load in full HD, play right to my TV. Of course, I plug this into my TV over here with an HDMI cable. And then for the audio, I just have a splitter that splits from my basic headphone jack over into a standard RCA cable and run that into my speaker system. So that's kind of how that works. So this OpenElec platform here, this is the one I'd recommend if you're repurposing a regular computer. If you are doing a Raspberry Pi, as I had said earlier, if I can find my Pi, if you are reusing a Raspberry Pi, so if you don't have a computer laying around and you want to build a media center, do it on a Raspberry Pi because you can buy these cheap. If you do happen to have an old computer laying around, repurpose an old computer into it because why buy a cheap Raspberry Pi when you have this, and you do not need a lot of system specs. You need something that is capable of streaming and internet. So I'm using the internal wireless card here to get the internet in. I'd love to plug it directly in. I'd probably get a little bit better streaming, but it's simply too far away from any of my network unless I want to run wires all through my house, and I'd rather not. Wireless works. All right, yes, I understand. Cookies, blah, blah, blah. Okay. So here they walk through what everything is. So basically everything is set up out of the box. This is so easy to install. Let's see what the news happens to say. I haven't looked at their website for a little while. All right. So looks like yesterday there was a new release. So I'm not sure which version I'm running, actually. I'll see about versions and stuff. Not sure if it'll fix, let's see, fix problems with the installer, fix an issue that prevents booting. I have noticed some of the plugins don't work very well. There's a YouTube plugin which works questionably well. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. There's a Top Documentary Films is a cool website where you can get a lot of cool documentaries on the website. It works great on the app on the Kodi's platform. It works okay enough, but not all that good. But anyway, you can come over here and check out the system resources required here. Let's go to the download page. That should tell us a little bit more about how to get it. So here is a kind of a legacy build. So if you want to grab an older one, if you're worried about stability, here are the newer stable releases here. So you can grab the x86, Intel, AMD, NVIDIA builds, WeTek Play, OpenElec box build. Then we have, here are actually, there is some Raspberry Pi builds over here. Mine is Raspberry Pi 2. Again, though, I generally use Open Source Media Center on the Raspberry Pi just because it was the first one I used on a Pi, and it no reason not to. But maybe you can just use the same platform for everything. So let's see. Come over here, download the disk image. Let's just see how big this guy is. I don't remember it being that large. Okay, so you can grab a tar, or you can grab the GZ. Let's just look at this guy here. Okay, so this is 200 megabytes. So that's why I'm saying you don't need a lot of space on your drive, especially if you're going to be feeding your media in through an external server. Now, I said I was going to talk a little bit about this chip. If I don't lose my chip. All right, let me transition over here. So here is, I want to say this is a 32 gigabyte flash drive. And I have all of my music on this. And the reason I do it this way is I don't worry about music streaming or failing to stream back and forth to anything. I don't buy a lot of music. I don't put a lot of music on here. So for me, it's just as simple to, anytime I do have something new, plop it right on this drive, pull the drive out, plop it in, reboot the system. And I just like doing that for the music, just because music is small. These drives are dirt cheap. That's why I do it that way. Now you can, what you can do is you can feed all your stuff in. In fact, for the video, I feed the video in through the network drives. And so that's kind of how we run with that. The other great thing about this is it runs Kodi, is there is actually an app. It is a free app. And I'm thinking it's probably available on an Apple too. I use it just on my Android. So my Android phone simply becomes my remote control. That brings me to the IR port. One of the reasons I wanted to use this computer and not a Raspberry Pi is because it has the IR port. You can program a universal remote to this platform. However, it is kind of a pain and it would take a while. I just have not had the time to do it because how little I actually watch movies, television, or anything with it. It's just as easy to control it with a phone or a tablet or anything else than it is to to control it with a remote control and take the time it would take to manually program it, because you end up having to manually program the remote and the box system. And you have to do that through a shell terminal. All right, so all that being said, what we're going to do here is I'm going to boot up the system and show you how that works. And I got to plug this in because, you know, this computer was purchased back a long time ago. Battery has died a long time ago. Okay, so what we're going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and dismount my camera from that, screw it in over here, and probably edit this part out. Okay. So what we're going to do here, if the reflections gets in the way, I'll change the lighting around. But the reason I'm using the SSD is how fast this guy loads up. And let me close this light down. I think that'll help. Okay, so there's my OpenElec. And we're online. And so right now it's just did a quick check every single time that you load this guy back into the system. It does a quick system check. Let me cover the hard drive up and see if I can't get the camera working a little bit better. Just trying to get the best view possible here. All right, so actually I'm gonna want the keyboard, so I'm gonna back this up just a little bit. You can kind of see there. Downside here is the just the angling that I'm having to deal with here, and I want to get this a little closer, but I want to be able to use the keyboard. So we're going to go ahead and keep this back here. All right. So what we have here is when we load the system in, we have, and I select this particular view here. Now there's pictures here, and I generally don't feed the pictures through here. I'm not going to bother with that. You have your videos and your movies. There's TV shows, and the TV show part is the one part I really can't get working too well. Here is your artists, and I can sort by the various artists, albums, songs, files. And then we have programs, which allow you to utilize the add-ons, and then our setup. So to actually get files onto the system, what we want to do is go down to the file manager over here. And so you can see where it says file manager and hit this guy here. And then we get this view here. All right. And I've been kind of experimenting with getting some of these guys in here. So you'll see a little bit of that experimentation. Just trying to find a good angle for the camera here so it doesn't fall off. Let me move my microphone as well. Hear me better. All right, so what you're going to do over here is you can come down, and it's basically like a two-tier system, which allows you to copy files over. So if you want to add a source, so the verbatim here is my little hard drive that's on the side. So if I click into there, you'll see it just has all my music listings there. All right, and then I think work group is just my LAN system, so that's not necessary. Hitting add source, if I wanted to actually add pictures, for example, I'd come over here to browse, and then I'd figure out what I want to do here. So I might pick this one. Looks like I don't have that set up for images or anything. So what I might do is, let's check the network settings. I'm just trying to remember where all my files and stuff are. Okay, so we're going to have to do a work group. So Open Media Vault is my internal networking system. And so here, if I wanted to add pictures, I could do that. And then, you know, you can do whatever pictures you want to happen to do. Let me see if there's anything innocuous in here. I think cat is pretty innocuous. So let's say, okay, we're going to use cat. So enter name is cat. All right. So now we've added cat as a source. So what we can do then is we can come over to pictures. Oops, not videos, pictures. Oh, I think I missed a step. There we go. So adding pictures. this is actually where I'd want to add it. I totally forgot about that step. The source gets you some general stuff. This is what we're doing here is we're going to add that. Let's see. Okay, so we're going to say there's cat is now added to our pictures. So now if I go into pictures and into cat, then I will have pictures here and I can view the pictures like this. So there we go. Now I should get 7 million views. We have cat pictures on YouTube. There we are. So this is TJ the cat. And there's me a long time ago with TJ the cat as a kitten. She's now an old fat cat. And there's TJ helping me to grade papers in college. Grading papers, the worst college part ever. There's me and the textbook and the cat. And the cat's as enthusiastic about that topic as I happen to be. All right. So that's kind of how the picture editor would work. Adding the files to any platform is equally easy. You just do the same thing. The difference is here, if I come down, let's see if I can remember how to do that part. Okay, there's OMV video. And I was trying to remember where I set what the file types are. Been a while since I've done that. Let's see, movies. It's a very intuitive system. You know, it might be over in the system. Look at the file manager here. No, it's not there. I'm just trying to remember. I can't remember where the where you set the. I do this a couple times a week when I'm just messing around with it, but. Now it might be. It might be here. Context menu. So hitting the C on the keyboard brings up the context menu. Over here, I can edit source. Okay. Okay, there you go. So once you get the source edited and you are in videos, here you can ask which database you'd like it to pull from. So there's music videos, TV shows, movies, and none. So this is a movie database. I'll do that. So you can set it to pull from the online movie database or grabbing local information. In this case, I did not populate any video files with local stuff, so I just rely on the movie databasing for a lot of that kind of stuff. All right. So it works the same way on our TV shows. For some reason, it has no idea what the logic is, and so every single one of those ends up being the very first album. The music works out very well. It will automatically download the album art as you go. It generally will download it as you pull everything. So if I come down here to artists, you can see that it's going to actually pull some fan art. And if there happens to be fan art in here you don't like, you can actually change that fan art. So hitting the C, we can come down and let's see. I know on movies you can do this. Let me see if you can do it over here. Album information. Okay. So over here under Get Thumb, here's the current thumb, and then there's some other remote thumbs that you can use. So you can kind of decide what you'd like to use as your album art. I think this is the one that's actually on my CD there. This is actually, I think this one's the closer to the actual album art. This is totally cool. So we'll go ahead and hit OK there, and it's going to update the album for that. And in many cases, you can adjust the fan art. I think it's not letting me adjust the fan art because I'm actually in the albums and not the artists. Let's have a quick look at that. See if I can change the fan art for Pink Floyd there. Okay. So again, pull up my C information, artist information. So here is where I can adjust my fan art. So the fan art is the image that's on the back. So I'm not a big fan of that one, but let's see what else other options we have. Now let's not use that one. Okay. I have no idea what's up with the fish. Must just be generic images. Okay, so there's really not a lot of good fan art. Let's just stick with the one we have. Bad example. All right, so thumb. The thumb will appear some places. Let's see if there's a different thumb art here. Oh, that's a cool one. I like that thumb art. So you can customize things. You may, depending on the size of your library, you may not actually have the full level ability to go in and change all those for all of them. But that is kind of how you can get in here and make some changes. So as far as the programs and other add-ons, you'll see this under music here. There's the add-ons section. And the add-ons, I don't really have any over here. But you can see that there's a lot of different different add-ons here. I just saw the Apple one as I said that. So some really fascinating things and some really out there things. I found a lot of these plugins are not the most, they're not always the most up-to-date and the most usable systems. A few of them, like I said, I really like. A few of them, maybe get back to the drawing board would be the best way to go. So if I go under videos and hit add-ons, the one I use a lot is TED Talks. So over here, here's my newest TED Talks and get this nice list. And then if you hit one of these, it will stream it right from online. And I know they release these under Creative Commons, so I know I can safely play a TED Talk on here without a big problem. All right. So this is, I love TED Talks, and the fact that we have the ability to load these is a cool thing. Go ahead and hit stop there. Other add-ons. Oh, I want to go add-ons, and I want to leave TED Talks. So I'm going to go up here. We're going to go up here. So over here, top documentary films. I like watching some of these, but I find some of these are a little goofy. Like if you look at top documentary films online, the actual film itself.com, they have a ton of things that works a lot. These here, I find I can usually only see four items here. I can see the highest rated here, four items, most voted, but really, there are so many different TED Talks out there, but there's nothing in all these categories. And this is one I really wish that would work better because I'd be spend a whole lot more time on this. Maybe it's good that they don't have it working quite as well. And then you'll find that there's a lot of different plugins for a lot of different things. So, you know, Couch Potato Manager, that's fascinating. Creation Today, here's Crunchyroll for those that like Crunchyroll. So there's a lot of different things. Some of these work well, some of them don't. Like the Do-It-Yourself Network sounded fun, except I could never get a video to play out of there. So that's just a little bit about the platform itself. I mean, it's a wicked awesome platform. This is actually what I use to watch movies and stuff on my Linux Mint KDE computer, just because the other video players wasn't working quite as well. You can also get Kodi on tablets. So here is my little Android tablet. And booting up the Android tablet, I can... Same exact thing. So everything streams directly from there. In fact, if I come over here and hit the update on the movies, it'll probably... go through an update. If I can remember how, I think you need to slide this over on the tablet version. There you go. Yep. Update library. Oh, done. Come over here, hit the update library button. If I can. It's like, no, I don't want to search. Come over here. Update library. There it is. Hit the update library button there. And what you'll notice is that on every device, Kodi is pretty much exactly the same. Of course, there's different themes that you can get. This is the theme that I prefer. And actually, if you want, you can change this background theme to something. You know, if you have a nice family photo or something you want as the background picture, you can go ahead and put that over there. Occasionally, we'll get some things where it does not pull right. I have probably less than 1% of my collection, but you'll see there's that movie. It pulls there. I have no idea what that movie is. That's probably because it doesn't understand my how my logic is working for running television programs, and so usually that's a TV program. Okay, let me, no, all right. Done with the tablet for a second there. All right, so that's kind of how that guy is working there. So the next thing I'll show you is the app. So what we're gonna do here is we'll boot this guy up. I'm not gonna enter my passcode on the camera, there we go. All right, so here on the phone, just hit your app there. And then here it'll be connected. So you can actually have, if you have multiple different media centers, you can give them separate names over here under the system settings. And I believe, let's see. No, no, leave me alone. Okay. I want it to not save the video resolution because I'm going to plug it back into the TV. No, stop asking me if I want to save the resolution. All right. So under internet access here, let's see, input devices. I'm just trying to remember where this guy is. These are those things that you you go back and you set up, and then I haven't changed the system for a long time here, so I have to remember everything. Okay, so there's your device name. So that's the name that's going to show up over here. So if you had multiple different ones, you might say like living room or bedroom or whatever else. So you can actually come in here and access multiple different systems by accessing the name. Over here, allow remote control via HTTP. This is the system that you have to have turned on in order to make the app work. So if this guy's turned on, then when you load up this app, it's going to, it'll, oh, no, cancel. Where's it at? This is another one of those things I never actually do. So you can come over here and you can add the, let's see, settings, theme, settings, about. No. Let's get back to my main page here. Okay, there you go. Back to this page here. So I came down here and I hit Kodi up here at the top. And this is actually going to be all of your installations. So if you want to pull another one up, you can come over here, hit the next. It's going to search. I'm not going to do that because I don't have another one on here. And then when you get back to this main screen, click on this and this loads up the system that we have. So you have to have this functionality turned on in order to access it with the phone app. And then let's see, allow remote control by programs, allow remote control by programs on other systems. So I have these turned on, which I believe will also enable you to do the remoting stuff. You can actually access the system with some other platforms. So here's how the app works and why I really like using the app. And I'll keep the screen over here too. So you can come down over here and you can select directly from your movies and you'll have your list of movies right here and you can just hit any movie. Let me see if I have something so old that no, I don't have. I was thinking I have an old old 60s copy of something. Anyway, though, you come over here, you push a movie, and then you can go right down here, and it gives you the actors here. And then if you click the button, it'll give you all of your cast. And if you click on any individual actor, it'll take you right to IMDb on your phone. So it's a really cool platform in that respect. So once you have picked your movie there, push the play button there, and it will automatically send your working indication down here to the bottom of the screen, and then your system's going to start to play. Of course, when I do this, I do it on my television set. So I don't have the computer right here. And then, of course, you can go backwards and forwards. I'm going to stop it right there so I get some DCMA takedown. You can do the same thing here with your music. So you can pull down your music here. And I love this album here. Just click on that. It's going to load up your information there. Again, I'm just going to stop them pretty quick. But when you can scroll back and forth, you can scroll back and forth to the various different songs that are on here. Or the play controls. I'll get there in a moment. And you also have the your basic volume controls, your sound, you have whatever else. And I believe the remote control here, I think what this does is this version of the app, I had these options turned on, which they are, then if somebody calls this phone while this is playing, it should actually pause everything on Kodi. I have not tested that functionality, and it's new to the platform. So there's that. Let's see. The next thing we wanted to look at on the phone app is your information down here. So literally this phone app is a full remote control. So I can go right back to the main page and I can navigate everything directly with the arrow keys here. And so, you know, if I want to go video, maybe I'll go down to video add-ons, go over to TED Talks, see what the newest talks are, and let's see. Push the center button there is like your control enter, and then that's going to load up a TED Talk. So that's how your Kodi platform works. Getting the OpenElec install, it's very easy. Just like any other Linux distro, all you do is you start with your download the file. It's a 200 megabyte file. Burn that onto a CD key. Plug it into your computer. Install it right from the drive here, and then a little bit of configuration to get your files in place. So if you happen to have just a few different video files, you can plug everything directly into the device. If you happen to have a situation where, in my case, I have a NAS drive that will distribute all of my movies, all of my music, and everything. So, in fact, I just pushed out an audio CD that I pulled the files from, and in my case, that's actually over on VLC is where I'd access that. I just hit browse folders over here and I can see the new file that I just added on. So in my case, where I have one central location with my files, I'm always going to come over into your sources in your file manager here, and then I'm going to add my various sources here and then utilize those throughout to utilize those guys throughout there to distribute my various files. So the things I'm still working on the platform, I want to look into a little bit of the creating the plugins, mostly just to see if I can modify and fix some of the plugins that I would really like to use that aren't, because there's not a lot of development. I'd love to be able to help with that if I can. I also want to figure out the TV shows, just so I can see if I can get them to work. And then, let's see, let's open a link here. Just try to see if there's anything else here. Okay, so here's where you set up your, if you do need to set up your networks, this is where you do it under your connections there. Here's your Samba servers. If you want to enable SSH or disable it, enable cron or disable it. So there's a lot of information in here. Let's see. Let's go back a screen. Let's look at system info. Okay, so I think there's 4 gigs of RAM in this guy here. Here's we're running at full screen. Here's your official operating system. Okay, so I'm running version 6, kernel 4.1. Total uptime, you can see it's 214 days. I usually keep it on. Occasionally, I'll turn it off. You can actually turn the system directly off. And with how fast it boots up, no big deal. There's your storage. Yeah, I think I'll blur out that gateway there. So here's system information. So you can see right now it's using like 4% and 2%, two CPUs, 1.3 megahertz, or I'm sorry, 1.3 gigahertz there. So you can see down here your system resources is using pretty much nothing. So this is OpenElec, quite easy to install, quite easy to work with. It's very intuitive, but this is what I use for just for moving the files back and forth across everything. And highly recommend this platform. Again, if you're using a Raspberry Pi, there is a distro for the Raspberry Pi. I generally use Open Source Media Center for that. So anyway, I hope that this helps you out if you are deciding on servers. Just an FYI, the other major media server, well, I guess that's more media server. This is more like a media player. Say another server out there is Plex, but that's a different type of program than this. This one here, it's very nice. It works well. I can actually come into my settings and I can like do things like disable the picture settings. There's slideshows. I'm trying to remember if I do it on this screen or another screen. But you can actually get on there and add or disable different things. Here's your appearance. This is where you can change the skin of the platform. There are other skins that you can get online. I just like the Confluence so much. I've seen a few of the other ones, played with them a little bit, didn't care for them quite as much. Initials, file lists. Okay. So I think that's about all I wanted to cover on OpenElec and Kodi. This is a very nice, handy system, and I hope that it helps you switch over to Linux.